you very much, Madam Chairperson, and may it please the board. I'd like to address four matters this morning. One is the context that brings us here. Second is the advisory opinions and expert opinions to which Invenergy has interposed no objection. Third is the matter of advisory opinions to which Invenergy has interposed objection. And fourth and finally, I'd like to discuss timing. First, the context. What is before the board today is a whole new proposal for a new power plant. On October 29, 2015, Invenergy filed an application with the EFSB for a 997-megawatt, two-turbine power plant costing $700 million. When CLF was before the PUC and the Invenergy hearing July 25th to 27th, and we raised the matter that Invenergy had only acquired a capacity supply obligation from the ISO for 485 megawatts, one turbine. We were told, everybody in this room knows what's going to happen in FCA 11, forward capacity auction 11 that the ISO ran on February 6th. Invenergy will definitely clear its second turbine. This is a 1,000 megawatt project. Everybody knows that this is a 1,000 megawatt project. We now know that that's not true. In FCA 11 on February 6th, Invenergy failed to clear its second turbine. We now have a proposal for a plant that is half the size of the original proposal, but one in which the cost estimate has gone up from $700 million to $1 billion, an increase of 42.8% for a plant half the proposed original size. A completely different proposal in other ways as well, and that is that the current proposal is much, much more complicated than the original one. The original application filed in October 2015 on page 46, section 6, 0.2, 0.3, 0.1, Invenergy said, and I quote, CREC is expected to operate at a high capacity factor, unquote. That is, be a baseload plant. But in order to do that, the application said, quote, water supply to the project must meet large volume requirements, unquote. We now have a new design before the board that would use much, much less water, and a novel plan to truck water across the state to the plant. It may be possible to do that. I'm not saying it's not possible. I'm saying that we have a new proposal that is much more complicated than the original one. In Invenergy's original proposal on page 55, section 6, 0.2.5. Regarding the sewer connection, Invenergy said that it would connect to the Burrillville public sanitary sewer. We now have a new proposal before the board, and Invenergy plans to truck waste away. It's a new design with a new novel proposal to truck sewage across the state. Again, we're not saying that it isn't possible, but it is a new and novel proposal. Second, let's acknowledge the request for new and additional advisory opinions for which there is no opposition from Invenergy. CLF, and for that matter, Burrillville, also requested that the EFSB hire its own neutral engineering expert, as it's allowed to do under Rule 1.12G, to be paid for by Invenergy, as permitted by Rule 1.21A. Invenergy has not objected to that. Obviously, we have a large new proposal. The EFSB would benefit by having advice and counsel of its own independent engineering expert. Invenergy has also not interposed any objections to CLS request for new or supplemental advisory opinions from DEM, the Department of Environmental Management, and DOT, the Department of Transportation. Third, I want to address some of the matters to which Invenergy has interposed objection. First, CLF is asking that the six currently missing advisory opinions be re-solicited by the board. We list those six currently missing advisory opinions on the very top of page 2 of our February 24th motion, lines 1 through 3. Those six agencies, just for the record, are the Burrillville Zoning Board, Burrillville Building Inspector, Burrillville Planning Board, and three state agencies, Department of Transportation, DEM, and Department of Health. Everybody here knows that we were here in this room on February 16th, at that time the EFSB discussed and ruled on CLF's motion to dismiss the docket based on those missing advisory opinions. And CLF's motion was denied. At that open meeting on February 16th, Chairperson Curran said on page 30 of the transcript, starting at line 13, quote, "I think that under the structure of the Act and the case law, certainly dismissal could be permitted, but it's not required under these circumstances." And CLF, of course, agreed with that, that with the missing advisory opinions, you could, in your discretion, dismiss the docket, or you could allow more time to get those advisory opinions in. And what Chairperson Curran said at that time was correct. Dismissal was not required. On February 16th, Janet Coit said, looking at page 32 of the record, starting at line 1, quote, "I want to make sure to say to CLF that I agree in many of the places where you pointed out problems and gaps, where you pointed out advisory opinions that aren't able to discuss." Continuing on line 23, "But when I look at the remedy for some of the gaps and problems, I don't think it's to dismiss this case. I think it's to get additional evidence on the record and hear whether or not the information we have in front of us meets the burden," unquote. Today, CLF respectfully asks the EFSB to do what members Curran and Coy were talking about on February 16th. Our specific request is on the bottom of page 2 of our motion. We're asking you, with regard to those six still missing advisory opinions, to do three things. One, direct those six agencies by a date certain to submit a new round of data requests to Invenergy, which data requests, if answered fully and fairly, would permit those agencies to provide their originally requested advisory opinions. Two, direct Invenergy by a date certain to provide full and fair and honest answers to that new round of data requests. And then direct the agencies to submit to the EFSB by a date certain the advisory opinions that are missing. We heard what you said on February 16th about the missing advisory opinions. Now we have a chance to get them into the record. Invenergy also objected to CLF's request in our February 21st letter to the EFSB to send the matter back to the PUC on the issue of whether or not the plant is needed CLF, as you recall in that letter, said that there was new evidence to present. Invenergy argued on page 5 of their objection, paragraph 1, and I quote, "The alleged new," the word new is in quotes, "evidence merely repeats the same arguments made on essentially the same material facts that existed at the time the PUC rendered its advisory opinion." And on page 6, Invenergy says, quoting again, "This was the exact same argument made by CLF previously and rejected by the PUC in its September 2016 advisory opinion." Respectfully, that's not true. If you look at the PUC advisory opinion, you will see that that advisory opinion recites that the PUC had before it the expert testimony of two different witnesses, Seth Parker for the division, who said, yes, the Invenergy plant is needed, and Bob Fagan for CLF, who said, no, the plant is not needed. You look at the advisory opinion, and the PUC recites both sets of testimony, and then says, we, the PUC, chose to agree with Seth Parker, the division's witness. We believe the plant is needed. What CLF wants to put back before the PUC is new evidence that did not exist at the time of the July 25th to 27th hearing before the PUC. Evidence that was not and could not have been introduced there that shows that on every point where witness Seth Parker and witness Bob Fagan disagree, in retrospect, it turns out that Fagan was right and Parker was wrong. The results of several reconfiguration auctions held since July by the ISO. The result of the forward capacity auction 11 on February 6, 2017, in which Invenergy didn't clear its second turbine. The results of the ISO's 2017 CELT report, that CELT for capacity, energy, loads, and transmission. Tomorrow at the ISO's PAT meeting, Planning Advisory Committee meeting, the draft of the 2017 CELT report is being presented. The final edition will be out a little bit later this spring. All of those, the reconfiguration auctions, FCA 11, the ISO's 2017 CELT report, show that in the PUC, the testimony of Fagan that wasn't credited at that time, in retrospect, was correct. Invenergy says on page 8 of its objection, and CLF agrees with them on this, they say on page 8, they, CLF, can present their arguments to the board, the EFSB, at the final hearing. And Invenergy, of course, is right about that. We could bring Bob Fagan here, but that's not a very practical way to do things. The PUC took testimony of two different witnesses and weighed that testimony. We can bring Fagan back and bring him here to the EFSB, but in effect, you would be doing an end run around the PUC, and you'd have to import all of that testimony from the prior PUC hearing and go down it point by point by point by point to see where Parker made his mistakes. We'll do that if the EFSB insists, but we think that a more practical way of doing that would be to send this question back to the agency, to the PUC, that considered it ab initio. Also on the matter of the PUC, Invenergy says at the bottom of page 8 of its objection, on the matter of cost, remember the cost of this plant, the half-size plant, is 42% larger than originally believed. Invenergy says the revised cost estimate does not impact the cost justification determination rendered in the previous, in the PUC's previous advisory opinion. It's a conclusory sentence. Invenergy is saying, it doesn't matter. Who cares? CLF is saying, let's ask the PUC whether it matters. Let's ask the PUC if they have an opinion on the new cost estimate. The same is true for Invenergy's objection on page 2. CLF asked, and Burrville did as well, that we get advisory opinions from Smithfield, Johnston, and Gloucester, from the tax assessors, from the planning boards. Invenergy says at the top of page 2, and I quote, Invenergy respectfully suggests that it is not necessary to request formal advisory opinions from the town's planning boards and tax assessors of the towns of Johnston, Smithfield, and Gloucester, merely because a small number of water trucks per day will be traveling through those towns. I understand why Invenergy would not want to ask those towns what those towns' opinions might be of that situation. But why don't you ask the towns whether they have an opinion on that situation? It's not for Invenergy to say, we've been thinking about it and we've decided the towns don't have an opinion. I want to turn my attention for a moment to the issue of the report from the Department of Planning. I will acknowledge a letter that went out from the Department of Planning to Invenergy earlier today. And I do not want to preempt anything that my brother, Mr. McElroy, will say about the Department of Planning advisory opinion. In Burrville's motion for additional advisory opinions, on pages 2 and 3, Burrville lists 7 specific areas that the Department of Planning, parts of the state guide plan that the Department of Planning did not address in its advisory opinion now before the EFSB. Invenergy's objection on page 3, footnote 5, that long footnote 5 on page 3, Invenergy acknowledged that those 7 portions were missing and explained why. They said, well, the Department of Planning said they didn't need to look at every little part of the guide plan. They looked at some and not others. If you hold up next to each other Burrville's request saying Department of Planning didn't address these areas, and you put that next to Invenergy's footnote 5, you'll find that they do not contradict each other. They are not mutually contradictory. Burrville said the Department of Planning did not address these 7 specific areas. Invenergy said, well, they told you why they didn't address them. They didn't address them. CLF is arguing that the EFSB can and respectfully should ask the Department of Planning to address the 7 areas that they told you in what they filed with you that they had not already addressed. Fourth and finally, I want to address the matter of timing. On October 29, 2015, Invenergy's original application contained 11 pages about its water plan. Those were pages 46 through 56, inclusive of both, 11 pages. On January 11th, they filed a new water plan that was 80 pages long. In 2015, this board gave state and municipal agencies 6 months to do their initial advisory opinions. Your order was dated March 10, 2016, and the due date for the advisory opinions was September 10, 2016. For an 11-page water plan, very straightforward, will be hooked up to a water main and will be hooked up to the sewer. It's easy. You allotted 6 months. You now have a new water plan, much more complicated and 8 times as long. I anticipate that Invenergy will argue that you don't need to give a full 6 months to agencies for advisory opinions. I'd like to say 2 things about that. First, I am not accusing or suggesting that Invenergy did have any sort of unwholesome scienter here. But if we took a hypothetical company, not Invenergy, in a hypothetical case, and that hypothetical company did have some unwholesome or meretricious scienter, it couldn't do better than to submit an 11-page water plan, run out the clock while agencies looked at that 11-page plan, then 15 months later submit a new 80-page plan and come to the EFSB and say, there's no time, let's move ahead, let's get this going, let's be speedy here.
Right.
We know the reason for Invenergy's indecent haste. We've discussed it here before. Invenergy made the election to acquire a capacity supply obligation from the ISO before it had its permits. As was discussed here on January 12, page 79 of the transcript, lines 1 through 5, Invenergy's election in that regard was not wrongful. It's not a reason to dismiss the docket. And we're not saying that the docket should be dismissed, and we're not saying that Invenergy's election was wrongful. On January 12th, Invenergy said correctly that sometimes power plants acquire a CSO, capacity supply obligation, from the ISO before getting permitted. They pointed accurately and correctly to the Footprint power plant in Salem, Massachusetts, that did that. And it is also true that not every power plant makes that election. Some choose to get permitted before they acquire the capacity supply obligation. The point here is not, it is not that Invenergy's election was wrongful. The point here is that Invenergy's election was Invenergy's election. They chose to go that route. And now they need to live with the consequences of their choice. Having made that election for reasons that seemed good to them, they cannot now be heard to say, let's hurry up, we have a deadline. CLF's conclusion here is that the message that we heard from the EFSB on February 16th, loud and clear, was let the process play out. Let the evidence come in. We have a new proposal for a new plant, new size, new water plan, new sewer disposal plan, new size, new cost. We're asking that the board follow its own recommendations from February 16th and get those additional and new advisory opinions in, allowing enough time to do that so that the process can play out fairly. Thank you.
Yeah.